Fernando, Presentation College Chaguanas, San Fernando Central Secondary School, and Queen's Royal College. Congratulations for making it to this quarterfinal round. This week, it is my pleasure to introduce to you our judges for this stage of competition. Mr. Akash Samru, Senior Reporter and Presenter, CNC3. Mr. Neeraj Tiwari, AmCham CEO. And Dr. Richard Taylor, Senior Lecturer, Inorganic Materials, Chemistry, University of West Indies. And joining me on stage is our timekeeper, Miss Jamie Simmons. Teams, your presence and your efforts to make your point represent our commitment to youth citizenship. You continue to demonstrate your responsibility and meaningfully contribute to issues that affect you, your classmates, and all other young people in our country. The insights and perspectives that you share today may one day influence policies and decisions that impact your future. At each stage thus far, schools were invited to draw randomly from our ballot box to determine their topic and their position ahead of the competition stage. The first motion is, in the event of a future pandemic, should unvaccinated individuals be denied access to public institutions and spaces? Proposing the motion is Holy Faith Convent, Kuva. And opposing the motion is Astra Boys College. The debate will be conducted as follows. The proposition will speak for 4 minutes to present their case. Then, the opposition will speak for 4 minutes to present their case. Both teams will then be given 5 minutes to confer before summary. The proposition will then have 2 minutes to summarize, followed by the opposition. Our timekeeper will ring the bell once to indicate you have 1 minute left. When your time is up, you will hear the bell ring twice. After which, a continuous ring should you go over the allotted time. Will the proposition speaker, Anya Philip Pitt of Holy Faith Convent Coover, please take the floor?
Those who fail to remember the mistakes of the past are condemned to repeat it. Philosopher George Santana. Ladies and gentlemen, today I stand before you to showcase my unwavering support for the motion, in the event of a future pandemic, unvaccinated individuals should be denied access to public institutions and spaces. Ladies and gentlemen, before I begin, allow me to define the key term of this motion, pandemic. According to the World Health Organization in 2021, a pandemic is defined as the A pandemic is defined as the widespread occurrence of an infectious disease over an entire country or the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I shall now set a parameter for this debate. We, the proposition, are not advocating that unvaccinated individuals must be denied access to public institutions and spaces, but rather, we are advocating that they should be denied access to public institutions and spaces. We are stating that as a country, we must have a plan in the event of a future pandemic. We must be prepared. We cannot be caught off guard like we were with the COVID-19 pandemic. Ladies and gentlemen, I will present compelling points in favor of the motion. Firstly, the public health imperative and how this impacts access to public institutions and spaces. And secondly, alternatives to access public institutions and spaces for our unvaccinated population. Firstly, you may wonder why is it that vaccinated persons should be allowed entry to public institutions and spaces and we should deny access to our unvaccinated population. The reason being, because our vaccinated population have protection from the vaccines which they have received, they are at an advantage in public institutions and spaces. According to the World Health Organization, in 2021, vaccines are the best preventative measure against infectious diseases. This shows that our vaccinated population are at less risk when in public institutions and spaces. This has been asserted by our Ministry of Health in 2021. 2021 as they stated that vaccines are the most vital defense against the spread of infectious diseases. Ladies and gentlemen, this shows that unvaccinated persons are at risk if they were allowed physical access to public institutions and spaces. Furthermore, there are alternative means of access. You may have noted that I said physical access. We, the proposition, are advocating for the denial of physical access because, as we have seen during the COVID-19 pandemic, because of our technological advancements as a society, we are able to access public institutions and spaces through non-physical means, such as online schooling, which we have all had to experience due to the COVID-19 pandemic, working from home, and even engaging in healthcare from online. According to the National Institute of Health and a recognized American institution in 2021, which states that before the pandemic, 40% of persons engaged in telehealth services, and after the pandemic, this rose to a staggering 100%. Ladies and gentlemen, this shows that there are alternative means of access which are safer for our unvaccinated population. So in conclusion, we the proposition are not only advocating that we should deny public access, we should deny unvaccinated persons access to public institutions and spaces, but that this is safer for both them and our vaccinated population. We must be prepared in the event of a future pandemic. We, the proposition, are here to act as your Justice League for preserving the public health and safety in the event of a future pandemic. Thank you for listening.
Will the opposition speaker, Andrew Debadeen of Asha Boys College, San Fernando, please take the floor?
Good morning. I would like to tell you a story. My story. It's a story of when my brother was born, he was diagnosed with microcephaly and cerebral palsy. Now, as you can imagine, these would cause a multiple of issues in his life. But notably, I would like to talk about the issue of vaccinations. My parents and myself are his primary caregivers. So, we must take into account that with the release of vaccinations, there's also the release of new articles from Yale and Johns Hopkins University that proves that vaccinations cause blood clots, myocarditis, pericarditis, and even neuropathy. So, my question to you is, how are we supposed to choose? How do we choose between my brother's care and our ability to care for him? My family, along with others, face the same challenges when the other evidence claims that COVID-19 vaccines cause negative effects. How are we supposed to trust it? If Yale and Johns Hopkins can provide studies showing the negative side effects of vaccines, how do we expect the public to follow suit and do the same? There's only one logical answer. We cannot. And people are fearful. They are fearful for their lives, they are fearful for their family lives, they are fearful for their children's lives. So how can we deny that the symptoms of the vaccine when government officials go against the studies of research from reputable sources? It causes distrust. It causes distrust in vaccines, and it causes distrust in the government in itself. So it is only in human nature to truly look out for yourself. And human beings are social persons. We thrive in community. Durkheim, the major proponent of the functionalist theory, believes that social institutions are necessary in maintaining social cohesion. So, if we are able to divide the public, we are dehumanizing society and causing chaos. The government pushes the narrative to divide. It coerces it causes animosity between two parties and destabilizing society. No, make no mistakes for the cost of these. Make no mistakes for the fall of and vulnerable in society. Imagine an elderly person, too frail to get vaccinated, now being denied access to hospital, access to a pharmacy, access to the place of religion. Depriving the most vulnerable among us of care, of education, is unjust, and the harm certainly exceeds the speculative benefits. And beyond this, the freedom itself is threatened as authoritative figures continue to bar citizens from public spaces out of personal medical reasons. Bodily autonomy is a fundamental liberty of society. We have the right to determine our medical risks and the risks we take on, which are essential to our human dignity. And we need to ask And we need to acknowledge that by barring persons from public spaces, we are also in direct violation of Article 3 and Article 21 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Policies that dehumanize any member of society dehumanizes all members of society. And yet it's clear that human rights violation, my opponent find it fit to deny access without considering valid arguments such as medical and religious contradictions. So, my opponents may make you believe that unvaccinated persons are a threat to society, but how is this credible when the WHO clearly states that vaccines are not 100% effective in preventing the spread? Vaccinated persons pose the same threat as unvaccinated persons in herd immunity. We must now take our own precautions in wearing our masks, socially distancing, and washing our hands. If these precautions are so much more sensible than completely banning unvaccinated persons from public spaces, is it not? Furthermore, it is laughable that these persons push the extreme measures when vaccinated persons play just as big of a role in the spread of unvaccinated persons. So, let it be known that if you must be pressured, reminded, persecuted, guilt-tripped, and even shamed for your compliance, you must absolutely be certain that for what you're being promoted is not in your best interest. Thank you.
Both teams will now have 5 minutes to confer. To our viewing audience, we now take a short break. Please do stay with us.
Quality delights you know and love. Devon Creams. Smiles in every bite.
Hey, hello guys. Welcome. Come have a seat.
Ooh, this is so stylish and I love the fabric.
Darlings, you must tell us where you got your new furnishings.
We got them locally at Standard. They've got new chic European furniture crafted from high quality material.
Oh, Standard?
No, it's Standard, their brand new Hive collection.
Experience luxurious European furniture at a price you will love. The Hive collection, now exclusively available at Standard.
Ask the Doctor's new season is here as Dr. Joel Tilak Singh covers a range of topics and, most importantly, answers all your medical questions.
Join us on Ask the Doctor live on CNC3 on Thursdays at a new time of 8:30 p.m. with a rerun on Fridays at 11 a.m.
Hello. Ezekiel, is this you? Master Alejandro! Madam Victoria! Madam Victoria!
It's him, and he's still alive, madam.
Hello? Mother.
Love Spell, a story based on love, drama, and betrayal. Monday at 8:30 p.m. and Friday at 8:45 p.m. only on CNC3.
Have had 5 minutes to confer and are now ready to summarize. Once again, the motion is, in the event of a future pandemic, should unvaccinated individuals be denied access to public institutions and spaces? Will the proposition summary speaker, Ishana Ramdean of Holy Faith Convent, please take the floor?
Ladies and gentlemen, I remind you of our opening quote. Those who fail to remember the mistakes of the past are condemned to repeat it again. The proposition has seemed to have forgotten the motion. I reiterate the motion. In the event of a future pandemic, should unvaccinated individuals be denied access to public institutions or spaces? The proposition speaker has mentioned their point of his brother's illness. However, he only mentioned that the point of vaccinations and did not stick to the motion of a pandemic. He has not once mentioned the point of a pandemic, nor has he mentioned why unvaccinated individuals should be allowed access to the public institutions. Furthermore, while we empathize with your brother's illness, are you selectively choosing that your brother should be given priority over those who actually deal with even more severe illnesses? Additionally, allow me to restate. Additionally, the opposition has failed to stick to our parameter, which states that we are advocating for the physical denial of access to public institutions, mentioning that persons can be denied to hospital and religious institutions. However, my first speaker, Anaya Philippid, has already mentioned that there are online alternatives to these, such as telehealth services, as well as online solutions for churches and other religious places. Furthermore, the opposition mentioned that by denying these unvaccinated individuals access to public institutions, we are denying them of their right to determine their risk of infection. We are denying them of their public rights. However, isn't overall life, the overall well-being of the public during a countrywide, a worldwide pandemic, more important than one person's individual right? Shouldn't we be prioritizing the overall health of a country, the overall safety of the world, over one person's individual health? Ladies and gentlemen, while we do acknowledge that there are negative thank you.
Will the opposition speaker, Mario Monroe of Astor Boys College, San Fernando, please take the floor?
Ladies and gentlemen, the proposition. Esteemed judges, let the gravity of this scenario sink in. Picture making a heartfelt decision not to take a vaccine, driven by personal beliefs or reservations, especially in the shadows of events like the heart-wrenching COVID-19 pandemic. Now feel the weight of such repercussions extending far beyond health considerations. Envision facing closed doors to public institutions, spaces that breathe life into our daily routine. Sense the emotional burden of being barred from educational facilities, workplaces, and shared communal areas. Esteemed judges, this isn't just a policy debate. It's a journey into the core of an individual's autonomy, highlighting the profound emotional impact society's decisions can have on those who, by their own choice, remain unvaccinated. In summary, this debate raises critical questions about human rights and individual autonomy. While my opponents here may have argued for health benefits, it's important to note that the World Health Organization, which they themselves have quoted, have also said that vaccines aren't even 100% effective most of the time. If they aren't 100% effective, what on earth is the justification for locking people up like caged animals if they don't want to take a vaccine? The potential infringement on basic human rights, like healthcare and equality, remains a concern. The call for universal vaccination overlooks valid exemptions based on medical or religious grounds, as recognized in international declarations and by the World Health Organization. Thank you.
This concludes this debate. Congratulations to both teams. Judges, your feedback?
I'll go first, Ayana. I thought that your style, I want to refer to the rubric here. I thought that you had a very powerful opening. I thought that I love the eye contact you were maintaining with us and the crowd. I'll only say that maybe you were a little too fast in the way you were speaking. So sometimes maybe you made some very good salient points, but they may have been lost on me while trying to digest one and two others flew by me. In terms of strategy, I really liked your structure in terms of defining the problem and defining the question. It was rooted in academia, I felt it was rooted in research, and I loved your reference in something maybe Dr. Taylor would appreciate as well. In terms of content, I thought your argument was sound from a public health perspective, and I did appreciate that you offered alternatives. It wasn't just fire for them, no. You offered some solutions as well. In terms of Andrew, I thought, Andrew, I loved, in terms of style, I love that emotional connection using the story of your brother. That is something that always resonates with people when you're trying to make your point. I do think that you also had an issue with your pacing. Really quick, it could be nerves, that's fine, it happens. I also felt like you read a bit too much. So Ayana, maintain that eye contact when I looked up at you. Sometimes your head was down and you were reading, so obviously in own debates we try to not read as much as that. And in terms of your content, I really like that when they came from a scientific approach, yours and Astra's was from an ethical standpoint, and I thought that was brilliant. In terms of the summary, Ishana, you all are on the proposition side, right? And I think at the beginning you were throwing some words at the proposition side as your team, right? You meant opposition. You corrected it halfway, but you started off by saying, you know, the proposition team. Yeah? And so that's fine. And you belong in the red house, right? I think so. You make a fantastic debater there. She said no, yes. And and Asha, I thought it was very, very nice, a nice sobering summary. Again, however, Mario, you read a bit too much for my liking, okay?
Akash summarized it very well. I would say, though, a couple of points to note. As a scientist, I would actually have needed a little bit more discussion about the scientific merits and the scientific limitations that would bolster your arguments. I think you could have probably dug a little bit more into that part of it.
And for me, I thought it was very good. Clearly, you all had prepared. There were contrasting styles. One was more formal. One was more storytelling in the approach. And both worked in different ways and had their limitations. I like that you all started to introduce the issue of the philosophical point of individual rights versus collective rights in a society. That made it very interesting, and I look forward to seeing which of you will progress. Well done.
Thank you, judges. We now take another short break, and when we return, it's Presentation College San Fernando versus Presentation College Chaguanas.
It's been 5 years since Paria Fuel Trading Company Limited, Paria, began its journey as a subsidiary of Trinidad Petroleum Holdings Limited. As we celebrate our five-year anniversary, we reflect on all the highs, lows, challenges, and accomplishments. Paria has contributed to the local economy through job creation, high revenue, providing a reliable supply of fuel, corporate taxes, and community programs. We are grateful for our employees, contractors, and loyal customers who have helped us reach this milestone. We are Paria, celebrating 5 years, the passion and energy to make a difference.
It was a season to be festive, but scorched was the ham. Decorations were not impressive, and the office party was bland. Christmas seemed to be missing one very important thing.
Shandy Karim, the official taste of Christmas. Ripa!
Talk to 100 women.
Name something about a bodybuilder that's a turn-off.
That's the problem right there. That's why I don't go to the gym. And right there.
Don't miss Family Feud. New episodes weekdays from 6:30 p.m. Marathon repeat weekly at 8:30 a.m. Saturdays at 8:45 a.m. and Sunday at 9 a.m. Only on CNC3.
The second motion is the government should regulate accessibility to certain internet content in schools. Proposing the motion is Presentation College, San Fernando. And opposing the motion is Presentation College, Chaguanas. Will the proposition speaker, Naveen Hariprasad of Presentation College, San Fernando, please take the floor?
As Buddha once said, what you think, you become. What you feel, you attract. And what you imagine, you create. During the age of adolescence, these young minds are most vulnerable and impressionable to the external stimuli of the world. From a Stanford article, 53% of students and children by the age of 8 had some sort of unrestricted, unmonitored cellular device, of which many expressed sympathies of addiction and dependence. This is of major global and national concern, as having unrestricted, unmonitored internet access is having adverse and severe effects on the mental development, aptitude, and attitudes of the youth of today's world. From an article published by the National Library of Medicine in the United States, a social phenomenon known as screen violence has taken root. This is whereby television programs and video games depicting violence onto others and physical harm of some sort is resulting in the decreased empathy of the youth and the increased aggressive tolerances and aggressive behaviors. This snowballs into an effective, or rather an effect of increased school violence and increased violent crimes at large. In addition, The easy accessibility of the internet is a gateway to which inappropriate materials can be viewed by said youth population. Pornographic material can be, for example, viewed by anyone at any moment, which is having devastating effects on the mental development of the youth of Trinidad and Tobago and the world at large. As a result of fried dopamine receptors, it has desensitized these youths to the acts and consequences. From an article published by the Daily Express, Education Minister Dr. Nyan Gatsby-Dully reported 69 cases of child pornography reports in the last 5 years, of which many were produced and distributed by the children themselves. She went on to say how many of these were also filmed in school environments. On the same note, a UNICEF article about grooming was also published, whereby adults and young adults use these online platforms to connect and manipulate young people and children into believing they have forged some sort of meaningful, real emotional relationship, when in reality, these young children are being preyed upon and used for some sort of sexual or other advantageous gains. This was most recently seen in an incident where a schoolgirl had a relationship with an adult in the Mayaro area, which subsequently resulted in her death upon making a police report. One might ask, is this not a parental concern than a school concern? However, one must remember that students and children spend a substantial amount of their time in the school environment where they develop a respective sense of self and identity. As a teacher of presentation, Colette San Fernando said, when at school, teachers take on the role of surrogate parents. Therefore, limiting and regulating access to certain internet content is substantial in this battle of protecting the children of this and future generations. It preserves and protects the safe school environment from shame and disrepute by those students who openly post videos of disrespect and indisciplinary acts, as recently seen in an incident in a South school involving a teacher and student. In closing, at its core, the unmonitored, unrestricted access to internet sites is a principal factor of many societal issues faced by and are as a result of the youth of today's world. But by starting small at the school level, an undoubtable positive impact on these issues will be achieved by establishing some level of control on the materials ingested by our students. Let us not feed our youth the poisons of the internet, but rather feed them the fruits of it. Thank you.
Will the opposition speaker, Covid Capaldio of Presentation College Chaguanas, please take the floor?
My dear audience, today we are roundly opposing the notion that the government should regulate accessibility to certain internet content in schools. We will present a solid argument to demonstrate the financial and logistical difficulties of this, the slippery slope of censorship, and the home-based nature of internet misuse. Now imagine, you're going to bake a cake, but you have no butter, no sugar, no flour. Does it make any sense to still turn on the oven? The proposition advocated for the government to regulate our internet. However, 74%, and I repeat, 74% of the schools in our country have no type of internet access. The proposition is trying to bake a cake with no ingredients. In fact, we in a school right now using mobile data networks to do our research. Why? No Wi-Fi. To add to the logistical impossibility of this, the Journal of Development Economics has stated that regulating internet access in schools costs $4 per student per month. Considering there are at least 300,000 students in Trinidad and Tobago, as per the latest Ministry of Education statistics, this would equate to a cost of over $14 million per year. Ladies and gentlemen, could you think of what we could do with $14 million? Well, we have some ideas. Instead of us depending on the government, to spend this money to regulate our internet, how about providers such as Flo, Digicel, and B-Mobile stepping up on their social responsibility and dip it into their pockets to regulate the internet? They can implement greater parental control on their Wi-Fi and data networks so that our youth are effectively protected from sensitive internet content. But that, ladies and gents, is not the only problem. How can we regulate accessibility when Section 4 of our Constitution guarantees us the freedom of thought and freedom of the press? The proposition's idea of regulation is beginning to sound like that C word. You'll know what I'm talking about. Censorship. Now, imagine you had to do a debate on sex education, as our colleagues here have to do shortly. You boot up the school's library computer and you eagerly key in a search to Google, only to find that, padow, you've hit a wall, a firewall. You search for breasts, blocked. You type in intercourse, blocked. Sex, condoms, STD, all banned from your research. Is this the Satan internet content that the proposition is alluding to? Blocking keywords is just one of the many ways that censorship can be enacted. Ladies and gentlemen, we are not North Korea. These are not the happy people that Iowa George was singing about. We have fought for our freedoms, and it would be foolish of us to flippantly entertain the idea that universal restrictions and censorship can do us any good. Thirdly, the proposition may hopelessly try to convince you that restricting internet access will curb misuse in the form of cyberbullying, violence, or sexually explicit content. However, I advise you, do not be fooled. As per the Trinidad Guardian on the 28th of February, 2022, the Ministry of Education has found that cyberbullying peaked during the pandemic, a time when students were not in school. In 2022, the Journal of School Health found that 80% of cyberbullying occurs from home and not in school settings. Furthermore, accessing explicit content in schools is indicative of more deeply embedded psychosocial issues and can be resolved through interventions such as counseling, not simply through web blockers. So, my dear audience, why would the government restrict our internet when this is not the root of the problem? Ladies and gentlemen, I trust that I have presented a compelling argument to you all and have explained why the government should have no business regulating access to certain internet content in our schools. Thank you.
Both teams, you now have 5 minutes to confer. Both teams have now had 5 minutes to confer and are ready to summarize. Once again, the motion is: the government should regulate accessibility to certain internet content in schools. Will the proposition summary speaker, Ronaldo Mohammed of Presentation College, San Fernando, please take the floor?
The opposition highlighted schools without access to Wi-Fi. However, I would like to bring it back to the motion, which specifically stated certain internet content in schools, though the motion is clearly referring to schools that provide internet. I'd also like to mention they reinforced our point, stating that cyberbullying peaked during the pandemic. We stated that students, when they do have access to unregulated Wi-Fi, do cyberbully. As my teammate would have stated, the inevitable foul play and streaming of inappropriate content would cause a great distraction and increased legal intervention among students. By the same token, students may click seemingly harmless links where they may encounter inappropriate material and may even search for these links purposely for their ungodly desires. Moreover, it can be used as a channel for grooming as it provides easy contact with vulnerable students. I would also like to add that students may use these unmonitored networks to cyberbully, as disguised untraceable accounts can be created, which may lead to their escape from proper ramifications. Additionally, the recent school fight endemic, which has been plaguing the media of Trinidad and Tobago, can be controlled. If proper measurements are put in place, social media will be inaccessible to these which utilize the monitored networks. Some may question how far the restrictions may go. Once again, the restrictions put in place can be specific to harmful and offensive content, such as pornography, websites that promote substance abuse, racial hatred, risk-taking behavior, or suicide, and even violence. None of these things would offer education to our leaders of tomorrow, but instead corrupt their young minds. Thank you.
Will the opposition summary speaker, Uzachi Bacchus of Presentation College Shigwanas, please take the floor?
Pleasant good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We, the opposition, come here to oppose the motion and say that the government of Trinidad and Tobago should not regulate access to certain internet content in schools. My opponents have made the point of cyberbullying. But as addressed by my colleague COVID, cyberbullying occurs at home. So how can the government regulate something that is being done in the homes of individuals? He stated an article by the Journal of Health stating that 80% of all cyberbullying cases occur at home. So can the government regulate this? No, ladies and gentlemen. Additionally, my opponents talk about the regulation of sexual content. But how are students to be sexually educated? Wouldn't they need some form of exposure to this form of content to lead to prepare them for the challenges which face them ahead in life? Additionally, they stated that an increase of school violence and filming is due to the fact that the government has not regulated this. But how do these students post these things? In the 74% of schools that don't have Wi-Fi, how are they posting it? They're posting it using data and at home, ladies and gentlemen. So how can the government be the ones responsible to regulate this? My opponents have brought articles from Stanford, but thank you for Guardian Media for allowing me to fact check this. Stanford literally contradicted what they say in stating that the students using phones has no impact on their well-being. My opponents have presented you an argument today, a doubles with no sauce, no slight, no pepper, no Guardian Media Limited, no sources. But thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We the opposition have presented you a lovely wrapped doubles, a wrapped argument with all the sources necessary, and have shown you that the government should not regulate internet content in schools. Thank you.
This concludes our second debate. Congratulations to both teams. Judges, your feedback.
So overall, I think a good debate. I think a particularly difficult topic to argue for and against or against. With respect to the proposition, I think in general, your opening was a little bit too general. It didn't really get to the main point or question of government regulation in schools. You would have made lots of references to access to content at home and in general. But I think that it lacked a stronger focus on the, you know, how it is that government regulates content in schools in particular. With respect to the opposition, I did get a sense that you really focused on government regulation in schools more so than the other team. I did like the points about the responsibility, though, in making your point about the responsibilities of the service providers in limiting access to content that students would have, you know, those kinds of content that we know students sometimes might want to access. And the whole issue of the impact of censorship to the educational experience. I think that was a good point.
Presando, good work. However, you come to a CNC3 production, you reference the Guardian newspaper. I don't know what the Express is. I didn't really register with me. But aside from that, I think what Dr. Taylor said was right, because if you look at your motion, I mean, the first couple of words, the government, and I thought you were, of course, very general, as he said, but you didn't really zero in on the government part of it. What does government intervention look like? What is the school climate with government regulation on internet? What does that look like? I was looking more, you know, for something along those lines in terms of Prez Shogunas. I thought that you all had a really nice use of one of my favorite storytelling techniques, and it's an analogous way of telling things using analogy, doubles, cake. You got the crowd on your side. I like that you even took, you were brave enough to redefine the issue. You brought it all about censorship. Even nothing about internet, nothing about firewalls, you talked about censorship, free speech, you went into the national laws. Admirable. I thought you were much more closer to the topic.
For me, I'm hungry now. But having said that, I do think, Prez Sando, you were too broad and didn't focus on censorship in school. Prez Shogunas, well done. You very clearly defined what you were going to talk about. You gave examples and facts to back up your position, and you used a very engaging style to deliver your points. Both of you, I thought, were excellent in how you presented.
Thank you, judges. We now take another short break, and when we return, it's San Fernando Central Secondary School versus Queen's Royal College.
C'est Searching for the ultimate healthy snack? Look no further than O Snacks Natural Almonds. Loaded with fiber, protein, and magnesium, they're an excellent source of heart-healthy, energy-boosting, powerful nutrition. Our almonds are the perfect addition to a wholesome breakfast. They're a great way to snack, at home or on the go, and they suit your fitness goals. Crunchy, delicious, and most importantly, guilt-free. What's not to love? O Snacks Natural Almonds. A healthier choice.
It's better together. Tastes amazing. This crazy combo make you want to get it. Cookie meat, the chocolate. Can't live without it. 100% goodness. Me want it. Want chocolate digestive. Rich chocolate with cookie crunchiness.
Cookie meat chocolate in Devon Chocolate Digestive. Better because it's both.
Now $2.
Get a loan at Bremont. The process is simple. Fast and efficient approvals. Receive funds within 24 hours once approved. And no penalty for early repayment. Located at 4 Gallen Street, Woodbrook. Remember, we like to lend.
Some of us like to test limits. But there won't always be second chances. Obey the speed limits. Maybe you don't value your life, but others value theirs. A message from the TTPS.
Talk to 100 women. Name something about a bodybuilder that's a turnoff. That's the problem right there. That's why I don't go to the gym. And right there.
Don't miss Family Feud. New episodes weekdays from 6:30 p.m. Marathon repeat weekly at 8:30 a.m. Saturdays at 8:45 a.m. and Sunday at 9 a.m. Only on CNC3.
The third and final motion of this quarterfinal round is: sex education should be part of the school curriculum. Proposing the motion is San Fernando Central Secondary School. And opposing the motion is Queens Royal College. Will the proposition speaker, Lakeisha Maynard of San Fernando Central Secondary School, please take the floor?
Mommy, where do babies come from? Gail, go and ask your father. Daddy, where do babies come from?
Well, Gail, when me and your mother was making you, she dragged me in the kitchen to make mac and cheese, and you come out.
So, a stork didn't drop me on the doorstep? That's what Sophie tell me her mother told her.
Esteemed judges, worthy opponents, friends, this situation is played out too many times in too many households. People, especially children, have questions. From mommy was this, to daddy was that. They bamboozle their parents with questions. And because we have a culture that is taboo around sex education, they're often told they're too fast or given random misinformation. Friends, we don't even tell children the proper names for their private parts. You say, sweetheart, that is a nene. Or darling, that is a punky. This is why we are in dire need of sex education in our school's curriculum. According to HealthThink Analytics, sex education refers to providing information to students on sex, relationships, and most importantly, body development. Having formalized sex education in our schools is a solution to breaking the stigma on educating children about their bodies. Eva Rampasad, the executive director of the Family Planning Association of Trinidad and Tobago, said that despite children already being exposed to sexual imagery in the media, there is still a taboo around implementing sex education in our schools. She stresses that sex ed is not about permissiveness, but about the power of knowledge to help children make good choices. Again, I stress, sex education is not about permissiveness. It's about giving children the power and the knowledge to make good choices. Our social environment already exposes to children and youth suggestive and inappropriate billboards, pornography, and rated R games. There is no reason as to why our schools should not be giving our children responsible and reliable information about their bodies. According to the CDP and SIECUS, in 2020, the U.S. states that had the lowest rates of teen pregnancy and STDs spread amongst young people were the schools that implemented sex ed, while the schools with the highest rates of teen pregnancy and young people contracting STDs had no sexual education. The same situation holds for many developing countries. My opponents are here to come with their whole chest and say that sex education should not be a part of the school's curriculum. But I wonder if they don't know that sex education already exists in our school's curriculum, and not in the way they think. Biology, HFLE, and literature are all subjects that provide sex education to children, as they all depict reproduction and our body parts. Is not learning certain parts of human anatomy and how they function sex education? Are not the relationship between characters like Romeo and Juliet sex education? They all are. If my opponents were to have their way, there'd be no biology, no HFLE, and no literature in schools. You all really want to agree with that? Now, some people may say that it's the role and responsibility of parents to educate children on these matters. But according to the Trinidad Newsday, 45% of young people who are sexually assaulted are assaulted from the years of 2015 and 2013 were violated by a primary caregiver. Too often, the only sex that a child receives at home is rape. After all that you have heard this morning, it is clear that there is a need for sex ed to be implemented in our schools. Let the conversation change to, Miss, how are babies made? My mommy won't tell me. Child, come here. We're about to start the sex ed class. Thank you.
Will the opposition speaker, Jonah Bujrat of Queen's Royal College, please take the floor?
All protocols observed. Firstly, I must commend my opponent for that tremendously passionate presentation. Unfortunately, however, the duty now befalls me to expose that at the core of their presentation lies one critical oversight. For the motion that they are proposing clearly advocates that sex education should be a part of not school alone, but the school curriculum. Merriam-Webster defines this word curriculum as the courses and subjects offered by an educational institution. Therefore, it can be inferred that the opposition, whether they realize it or not, is actually arguing that sex education should be a mandated subject in schools. This is the proposition that we vehemently oppose because we see that it has a proven track record of failure and to actually effect positive change, and the fact that there are far more superior methods to address sex education. So, according to the WHO, sex education is supposed to give young people detailed, accurate, and age-appropriate information about their sexuality to prevent them from facing the negative outcomes of sexual imprudence, such as STIs and teenage pregnancy. Undoubtedly, this is a very sensitive topic, one that requires personalized attention. So why are we even considering generalizing sex education by making it into a subject? I mean, come on, be real. You know, how do you expect a teacher to address a young person's unique individual psychological concerns concerning sexual education when usually that teacher is unqualified, impassionate, and being puppeteered by the strings of an infinitely broad curriculum? Listen, this one-size-fits-all approach to sex education is totally ineffective, but you don't have to take my word for it. Take South Africa, for example, where though sex ed has been a part of their curriculum for almost 20 years, they still report up to 23,000 cases of teenage births a year, according to the Gauteng Health Department. If you find Africa is too remote, let's bring it down to the United States of America, where although they mandate in 39 states sex education to be a part of the curriculum, the CDC reports that adolescents, though they make up only a quarter of the population, account for 50% of the sexually transmitted diseases contractions in the US per year. So the inadequacies of sex education in the curriculum are clear and evident, but what are the alternatives? Well, we can use the United Arab Emirates as the archetype, because they had one of the lowest teenage birth rates in 2021 at 0.3%, according to the World Population Review. And yet, they do not have mandatory sex education in the school curriculum. Instead, they have online platforms such as Quraaz that ensure anonymity and confidentiality in addressing teens' questions regarding sex. They also incorporate optional personalized programs by highly qualified individuals to any person seeking sexual advice. Their numerous community outreach programs are consensual not mandated, and cater to meet individual needs, and that is a far cry from anything that sexual education in the curriculum could ever achieve. Now, my ultimate point is that not only is sex education in the curriculum ineffective, but it also poses a detrimental threat to the ideological development of our children. For instance, the sex education curriculum in California includes the dissemination of specially curated textbooks to children as young as 10 years old. Now, this may seem innocent and all well and fine until I divulge to you the content of these textbooks, for they include tutorials on all forms of masturbation, sexual role play, sexual foreplay, and blood play, and other sexual acts that I don't feel comfortable talking about. So the book also portrays parents, especially religious ones, as ignorant and untrustworthy in the matters of sexual education, thus setting children at variance with their parents at young ages. So now I ask you, do we as a country want to allow this to infiltrate? Never.
Both teams, you now have 5 minutes to confer. This is Make Your Point. Both teams have now had 5 minutes to confer and are ready to summarize. Once again, our third and final motion is sex education should be part of the school curriculum. Will the proposition summary speaker, Genesis Pereira of San Fernando Central Secondary School, please take the floor?
Hair, elbow, knee, vagina. Dear audience, why the shock? I've simply listed body parts that human beings have, though you all reacted to one more than the others. Why is that? Are we ashamed of our anatomy? It is this very shame that encourages the spread of misinformation and secret keeping surrounding sex. How often have our young people felt embarrassed to report rape? How often have our children used confusing euphemisms such as cookie or flower when reporting abuse? Sex education already exists in the hidden curriculum. We learn about it in literature class, HFLE, and biology. Yet we only shudder when we call a spade a spade. Surely, professionals must be employed to address those topics. As a matter of fact, my opponents themselves reference professionals being employed to answer the questions that youth in the United Emirates have about sex. Isn't that a form of sex education? Research has supported my colleagues' claims that medically accurate sex education reduces the risks of teen pregnancy and STD transmission, some of which are incurable, ladies and gentlemen. The assumption that sex education will erode traditional values and religious principles is just that, an assumption. We have already learned to coexist with conflicting ideas in science and religion. For instance, Adam and Eve versus evolution, creation versus the Big Bang. Why should this be any different? Now, my opponent has cited concerns about the faults of sex education, specifically in America. Surely, we acknowledge those concerns. However, simply because part of the machine has malfunctioned does not mean that we throw out the entire machine. Providing accurate information does not equate promoting the act. My opponents today represent the opinion of small-mindedness. Do not allow them to convince you. Thank you.
Will our opposition summary speaker, Jonathan Ramsinder of Queen's Royal College, please take the floor?
I would like to start off asking, do we really want a country? Do we as a country really want to allow this putrid form of indoctrination to infiltrate our society using the deceitful guise of sex education in a school curriculum? As stated by the proposition speaker, Jonah Bujarat, in Trinidad and Tobago, there has been an attempt to introduce sex education into our curriculum in the form of HLFE. However, it can be seen that according to the Newsday, there has been an increase in the amount of unprotected sex amongst teenagers since 2018. This is an example of the failure of sex education in our country. This is due to the unqualified staff teaching these topics. How can we have this in our curriculum? The proposition would have stated that in the United Arab Emirates, they teach that in schools. However, I'd like to tell them that we are not opposed to sex education, By the motion, we are opposed to sex education in the curriculum, which the United Arab Emirates do not have. Moreover, how can we have introduced sex education into a school curriculum that has the potential to encroach on the religious beliefs of parents and how they wish to upbring their children? Notice, their own children. You may ask, what do I mean by that? Well, modern sex education, as previously stated, encourages and sparks curiosity in teenagers to engage in some sort of sexual activity. This contradicts most religions that advise persons not to engage in premarital sex. Hence, why would you want to introduce this into our school curriculum? You may ask where the topic of sex education first started. Well, it started with a man named Alfred Kinsley. He was a sexologist whose research was the basis for the sex education curriculum we all know today. You may ask why I'm bringing this up. Well, according to the Washington Times, Alfred Kinsley has stated that pedophiles were misunderstood and their punishment was unjust. I don't think I need to tell anyone here who pedophiles are. Do you really want children to be taught a curriculum that was written by a man who believes this? I think not. Thank you.
This concludes our third and final debate for this quarterfinal round. Congratulations to both teams. Judges, your feedback.
I think that for Lakeisha, great use of blending of styles in how you presented. So, you know, you started off almost with the theatrical and then went more factual, so it was good. Of course, you use your time very well, and you created a flow in your points and tried to connect with the audience. So that went very well for you. Jonah, I thought you were very authoritative. You were very clear with your points, you brought them across well. I thought you used data and so on. I thought there were a couple of times you may have missed an opportunity, such as referencing CDC data, which had been referenced by the proposers. You may have linked what you were saying to that, so that it wasn't that you came with only what you prepared, but that in a debate you were able to respond.
Sando, I felt like I was in Queens Hall for a little while, with the little performances, a little Best Village to start, rooted in information and data, as Mr. Tiwari said. I also like that you were very raw about it. You were able to catch people's attention. You were able to, you know, demystify a lot of things that are notions people may have had about sex education and what it entails. The only criticism I really have for you all, and again, good use of examples and whatnot, but I thought maybe you all could have said something on how sex education as a class fits into an already packed school curriculum. With respect to QRC, Jonah, very, very powerful presentation. A little buffing in your style, that's all right, that is fine. I understand that completely, especially when you're trying to come across authoritative sometimes, you know. I felt like you all looked down a little too much for my liking in terms of reading. And while I liked your use of other jurisdictions, the UAE and whatnot, even though you thought you were bringing it closer to home, I was more thinking, apart from geographically, culturally. So maybe a more culturally appropriate example, maybe region-specific, something like that.
I completely concur with my colleagues. I thought that both speakers were, both first speakers were actually very good. And I appreciated the fact that their styles were actually contrasting. I think that's good for a debate setting. A couple of points. I think that the proposition did really make some good points about the purpose and effectiveness of sex education and how that links to teenage pregnancy. But I also thought that the opposition did the same thing in respect of how it is that sex education actually does not help the issue of teenage pregnancy. So I thought that those were good poignant points that were quite evident in your presentations.
Thank you, judges. We now take a short break while our judges confer and tally the results to determine which four of our six schools will be moving forward to the semifinals of Make Your Point.
Thank you.
your point, and the results are in. Congratulations to all six teams. The three teams automatically moving forward, having won their respective debates, are Holy Faith Convent Coover, Presentation College Chaguanas, and San Fernando Central Secondary School, and the fourth school, joining them in the semifinals, Queens Royal College. Let's give another loud round of applause for the schools exiting the competition for a phenomenal showing to reach this far. We now progress to the draw. I would like to ask one representative from each school to select a number from the ballot box. One representative from Holy Faith Convent Coover, please select from the box. Presentation College Chaguanas, San Fernando Central Secondary School, and Queens Royal College. The number you selected, and the letter P for proposition, or O for opposition, on that number represents the topic and the position for the semifinals. Congratulations once again.
You're watching CNC3.